Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Lamont Open House at Home. I'm Maureen Raymo. I'm the interim director of Lamont-Doherty Earth Observatory at Columbia University. At Lamont, we are on the forefront of climate and earth science every day. And while our discoveries inform the scientific community about the wonders and processes on our planet, telling the story of our work and reporting our science, putting it all into a cogent, accurate context is absolutely essential. At Lamont, helping the media tell the climate story is very important to us. Right now, we convene our second annual Beyond Hot Headlines panel to explore the vitally important nexus where our science and the world's journalists converge. Specifically, today's panel is a discussion of managed retreat. In simple terms, managed retreat is the purposeful, coordinated movement of people and buildings away from risks posed by climate change, risks such as rising sea levels, escalating heat and humidity conditions, and other extreme weather events. This is an aspect of climate change that is becoming more and more relevant, and so it is becoming an even bigger story to report and to get right. So today, it is my great pleasure to introduce our panel and the moderator, Andy Revkin. The journalists that are joining us are Vanessa Murdoch, a longtime meteorologist and reporter for CBS2 in New York. David Wallace-Wells, deputy editor and climate columnist at New York Magazine, and also author of the bestseller, The Uninhabitable Earth, Life After Warming. Rosanna Shaw, an environmental reporter at the Los Angeles Times, who was a 2020 Pulitzer Prize finalist, who with a graphics team for reporting on innovative sea level rise stories. The scientists on our panel are Susanna Carmago, who studies the dynamics and impact of extreme weather in a changing climate. She is the Marie Tharp Lamont Research Professor at Lamont-Doherty Earth Observatory. And also joining us is Andrew Krukashevitz, a senior staff associate at the Earth Institute's International Research Institute for Climate and Society, also called IRI. Andrew focuses on connecting climate data to decision makers so they can better prepare. The conversation and the panel will be moderated by Andy Revkin, a journalist focused on climate since the 1980s, who last year became the founding director of the New Earth Institute Initiative on Communication and Sustainability here at Columbia. Welcome to Lamont Online. Welcome to Open House. Andy, I'll pass it over to you. I look forward to this wonderful, thoughtful, and important discussion. Thank you all.
Great. Thank you for setting the stage. And it's great to see you from a distance. Someday we'll get back down to the campus and we can all convene directly. And it's great to have an audience coming here to explore a really critical theme, which is by whatever means you call it, we have to figure out how to learn more resiliently. In a changing climate and with communities changing and fast forward as well. And you're going to meet these journalists and scientists who are all focused on that interface between communities and risk and how we go forward. So if those who are on the call, you can all kind of pop into the visual mode, that'd be great. And we'll get started here. I am Andy Revkin, and I've been running an initiative on communication and sustainability for about a year now, building something as we've all moved online with all the innovation and turbulence that comes with. So today we have this discussion around how the reality of human-driven climate change is increasingly making some communities uninhabitable, with worse to come should heat-trapping carbon dioxide continue to build in the atmosphere. At the same time, many communities, rich and poor, continue to settle and build in regions already prone to extreme storms, fire, and flooding. As some geographers put it, we're building essentially an expanding bullseye, and that's the nature is throwing the darts, but we are building in ways that are completely creating our own vulnerability. Even if climate weren't changing, we would be creating that expanding bullseye. And the idea is to dive here behind the headlines. The headlines are always simplified, and today you're going to kind of hear from in more depth what's actually going on and what we can do with innovation in journalism and also in science communication to build more resilience. It's a great mix of guests you'll meet in a minute. The key thing here is to understand that the vulnerability that has been increasing profoundly in recent years because of where we settle and how we build is something we can work on, even as we work on the bigger challenge of reducing greenhouse gas emissions that are driving climate to change. I'd like to start here with sort of a round of just asking each of you how you're doing. This is a key moment on the planet for everyone. We've all been in flux. We are all living in different circumstances. And my question to you is, how are you faring these days? And where is your hope barometer set? Rosanna Shah at the LA Times, where in the LA region do you live? How's your particulate matter doing? And how are you seeing things right now? You know, you had a great achievement with that package that we'll talk about in a few minutes last year in the LA Times. But how are you doing?
Yeah, the air is finally getting clear again in LA from all the wildfire smoke, and it's finally not 90 degrees today in October. We've had a series of heat waves that have been pretty much a wake-up call. Yeah, I mean, as for hope, you know, I think we need hope. So I'm kind of more on the optimistic range. Sometimes I fluctuate onto the other end of the extreme, but you know, that's why I'm still writing about these issues and actively looking for solutions and looking for new ways to frame this issue for people to care. And I think that's why we're all here to talk about this and why we have so many young folks out protesting, speaking out, really trying to ask for systemic radical change to the way we think about this issue. But yeah, it's been interesting in California. I feel like we are an interesting state that is on the one hand very woke and progressive and ahead of the conversation on climate change, but on the other hand also symptomatic of all of the reasons why we have not moved faster. So yeah.
we'll talk more about those specifics in a minute. It's just great to know you're doing okay. Where roughly do you live?
I live in, if you look at a map of the city of Los Angeles, right in the middle, and the neighborhood is called Mid-City.
So yeah, some of that social turbulence was all around you too. It's an amazing time. Yeah, one of my sons lives in LA, and it's been an interesting year to say the least. David Wallace-Wells, we'll get to your book and your work in more depth in a minute, but this is just a sort of a hello, how are you doing moment. And you know, you're famous for laying out the really calamitous future that lies ahead, let alone what we're experiencing now. But what do you, on a day-to-day basis, and also because you've been covering COVID-19 in depth as well, how are you feeling right now? What's your hope barometer like?
You know, mostly I'm a former colleague of mine wrote a piece in Slate maybe a month ago that said he was hoping someone would hit him over the head with a shovel until November 4th. That's sort of where I am. I'm, you know, to the extent that I'm worrying about the future, it's the very near term future and the election. I think there's actually been a fair amount of relatively good news about climate in the sense that I think a lot of the worst case possible futures seem increasingly less likely. But I think that one of the things that COVID has done has made, you know, has given governments an opportunity to make really large scale investments that they don't get very often. And in most of the world, they're not taking that opportunity to push for a greener future. And that's really concerning. It may be that we've learned from this experience that governments now going forward will be much more active than they've been over the past generation. But it may also be that once we get through, you know, or over the hump of COVID, we also lose our appetite for the scale of spending, which would mean functionally that we've lost our opportunity to really stabilize the Earth's planet at anything like the level that it is today. Right. So who knows? But I'm sort of tabling everything until the election, like I think a lot of Americans.
For sure. It's hard to think past that juncture. I was just on a conversation last night about the same thing. And so many of the, whatever track you choose going forward, requires such a profound shift in practice and investment in research and in energy regulations or whatever your approach. None of them really could feel like they have a way to get traction until January, late January, assuming that we even have that transition go smoothly. Vanessa Murdoch, you're, as you were saying a few minutes ago beforehand, you're in a day-to-day basis, you're in a relationship with your viewers here in the region around weather. And we'll get to that in more detail in a few minutes, but how are you doing? Where in the New York area do you live? And how are you handling this turbulence? It's sort of like extreme weather.
Yeah, I live in Edgewater, New Jersey, so just across the river and about 20 minutes from Lamont. So this is nestled right in between lots of hot spots. Weather-wise, while we've had some really good severe weather this summer, I think it's much more calm than many other places in the country. So for that, I feel very lucky. I'd say how I'm feeling is a combination of super sad, mostly sometimes angry. I feel like I need a therapy session. But I think with regard to climate change, I'm probably more hopeful than I've ever been. And that is because I do feel that there's more attention being paid and there is more energy behind the movement. But the sadness comes from everything else that we cover on a daily basis in the local news. And
yeah.
Sadly, people are being affected by everything happening. And just like David, I feel that the upcoming election is the most important of my lifetime. And I hope that's the only time I'll have to say that, because there's a lot riding on it.
That's true. So Susana Camargo Borgia, I know you have, your roots are in Brazil, right? But and you've been here digging in on extreme climate and weather events and how we chart a more resilient future. So how are you doing? And are you, is that a, I assume that's a, not a view out the window behind you, but so where are you and how are you doing?
No, that's from my fall sabbatical. So just reminding good times. So I am in Nyack, New York, very close to Lamont, beside the Hudson River, a little north of New York City. My main specialty is hurricanes. So this, as you know, this hurricane season has been absolutely horrifying and very active. So I have been dealing with keeping up what's going on with the hurricane season and some answering the press on some of the events as they happen. Similar to others, trying to keep my head in place until we have the election, which is hard.
Yes, it's incredibly challenging. Andrew, you're focused on the same kind of turbulent weather and community resilience in places all around the world. We were talking about this a few months ago on my webcast about the Bay of Bengal in that area. And what's so interesting about your work is you kind of are the connective tissue between data and the scientists who are dug in on questions and communities. And we'll get into your work in a few minutes too. And just want to again get your sense of the world and your hope barometer. Where is that needle these days?
Yeah, thanks, Andy. And thanks everybody for the opportunity to share some thoughts and to have this discussion. For me, as Andy mentioned, I mean, for the past approximately 6-7 years, the majority of my work has been more forecasting and in, let's say, meteorology related. So like short-term forecasting of extreme events, specifically impact-based forecasts for humanitarian organizations. So working most closely with the International Federation of Red Cross, but also other UN organizations as well in different parts of the world. So I've spent most of my time traveling to different places, seconded into different types of situations. As Andy is mentioning, one of the posts was with some of the UN agencies in the Rohingya refugee camp, for example. So yeah, I mean, that was my life for a while. I think very much on what's happening now, what's happening in the next few days, and what's happening in the next season, but very much forecasting. And now it's different. I mean, I haven't spent a solid set of months in New York. I'm from New York, the New York area, and I lived in various places in the New York tri-state area. Now I'm in Brooklyn for the past 10 years. And yeah, it's different. I find myself thinking a lot more about obviously local and national situations, social situations, political situations that I didn't realize how much I was able to, I don't want to say dismiss, it wasn't that, but they weren't present. I didn't have to confront them every day. So, and also on from the professional perspective, I find myself doing a lot more of what Andy mentioned, thinking about integration into decision-making. What are people's perception of risks? What is appropriate dissemination? Where's the accountability and responsibility with me kind of propagating and or adding value to climate and other information? So yeah, it's changed. And I mean, I am hopeful. I'm happy that there is a tone of opportunity so far shared in the panel, because I feel we must be. And maybe that's me just in trying to project that, but I have been thinking a lot more about that, specifically about the around the concepts of accountability, responsibility, and like data governance and data privilege, which I think comes into play specifically for situations like managed retreat. So we could talk, I'm glad to share more later.
Yeah, and that idea of data privilege, I assume open access, making sure that we live in a very uneven landscape in the world in terms of vulnerability. And the communities that are most vulnerable are usually the same ones that are least have least access to data and the most limited engagement tools. There are ways to innovate there. And I think there's been a lot of innovation because of lockdown in some ways. So we'll get into that as well. I'm not sure if folks can see David Wallace-Wells in 2017, I think it was. You wrote this piece for the New York Magazine. And this was a pretty epic shock to the system, the communication system. You know, a lot of people, including me, for 30 years, you know, 1988, I wrote this cover story in Discover magazine about global warming and what's to come. So that's 30 whatever something years ago, half a life ago for me. And, you know, a lot of other writers had done books and stuff, but this one really, I think, is it correct? It was the best-selling or most read article in New York Magazine history.
It was for a while. It later got passed by, we did an excerpt from Michael Wolff's first Trump book.
Okay.
For a year.
Another kind of crisis. So, and that resulted, of course, in the book, The Uninhabitable Earth, A Story of the Future. And I like the word there, meaning it's a story of the future, not the story of the future. This all reminds me of the Christmas Carol, the Ghosts of Christmas Yet to Come, where Scrooge is there, you know, holding on to the robe of the ghost and saying, is this the future that must be? But you really did stir things there. Can you talk a little bit about how that worked? You know, do you feel it was successful in the end? Obviously it was successful as a book. It was a number one bestseller. And how's that played out? You know, and what was the goal in the context of getting people to do stuff?
Well, mostly the goal, at least in the first instance, was to share the set of wisdom that I felt I had sort of stumbled on. I'm not a science journalist. I'm not a climate journalist by background. And I've written and talked about how I've never really even thought of myself as an environmentalist. But once I started sort of poking around the research around, especially the sort of higher end possible outcomes of climate, I was just terrified and felt that what I was reading in those papers and in conversations with scientists just did not match the tone of climate coverage almost anywhere. I mean, especially I would say on TV news, but all the way through even, you know, even the kind of fringe lefty magazine public, you know, I basically felt nobody was writing about the possible scariness of that future in a way that really mirrored the findings that were coming out. And I felt a sort of a, you know, journalistic obligation more than a environmental obligation, more than a political obligation to just sort of share that story. It felt quite profound to me, quite intuitive that, you know, the world would be shaped in very large ways by these forces, and much of it remained in our control, but even a best case scenario was going to really give us a really transformed world, that we would have to be doing quite a lot of adapting to, not just in, you know, the case of sort of managed retreat, but really all across the board. And I wrote that article in 2017, sort of with that naive purpose in mind, that is really just sharing the story. I hadn't conceived of it as achieving a political purpose or as being a part of a communications campaign. But watching it even over the first few days playing out, I felt very clearly that it illustrated something about the history and possible future of our conversation about climate. Namely that many more people, there were many more people like me out there who had intuitions about how scary the story was, but didn't feel that much of the writing about it or storytelling about it served those intuitions. And that while, you know, fear-mongering and alarm probably shouldn't be the only way that we talk about these issues, that there it had sort of been underserved as an emotional need for, you know, the general audience. And, you know, I think my book is a little less focused on worst case scenarios than the article is. The article's really, it gets into 4 or 5, even 8 degrees of warming. The book is really between 2 and 4, which is much more where we're likely to end up. But I think over the last few years, the public conversation has moved in a considerably more alarmist direction. I think that the UN IPCC 1.5 degree report in 2018 had a lot to do with that. I think that the activism that sort of grew out of that or in response to that report, from Greta and the school strikes to Extinction Rebellion to Sunrise, has played a role in that as well. And I think that extreme weather has played a role in that too, that especially in the Northern Hemisphere, up until a few years ago, you could kind of pretend that climate change hadn't arrived where you lived. You know, you could see its impacts in the equatorial parts of the world, but you know, you could kind of pretend that it was still in the future and still a distant threat geographically. And I think the last few years have taught those of us living in the sort of wealthy, powerful, privileged parts of the world in the West that climate change was a pretty present tense and imminent threat as well. And I think for all those reasons, the public has gotten much more concerned. And as a result, you know, I think we're moving much more quickly on climate policy than we had been in the past. I don't think that, you know, you can claim that progress is simply the result of alarmism, but I do think that it's been helpful to have more people speaking more forthrightly and more urgently about the crisis. And you see that in the polling, that, you know, a few years ago, the number of people who were alarmed about climate was roughly equal to the number of people who were sort of indifferent. Now it's 4 times as high. You see that in the, you know, reflected in policy plans and pledges everywhere from, you know, European prime ministers to British Parliament to Xi Jinping in China to, you know, here in the US, Joe Biden proposing a climate plan that is often described as sort of milquetoast by climate activists, but is 20 times as large a spending effort as Obama managed under his presidency. And those two facts are both true at the same time. We're probably not moving fast enough yet, not as fast as the science demands. And also we're moving much, much, much faster than we were up until very recently. You can see that movement in the private sector too. So I think, you know, I think we're seeing a lot of progress. If we had a timeline that extended indefinitely or even over centuries, I'd be feeling really great about where we're headed. The concern is that those timelines are really short. And so I think we probably need even more progress, even more acceleration. And I think maybe as a result, who knows, but maybe even a little bit more alarmism in the mix too to push us along.
There's a question that came in from Lewis Kay saying, please let's drop the phrase climate change, substitute instead words that convey the sense of required immediacy of action, such as climate catastrophe, climate emergency. Of course, The Guardian made it, they changed their style book. I have some concerns with that approach. I think it ends up, it's like in that, the great movie, the rock and roll parody, turning your amp up to 11, 11 just becomes 10. And, but I don't know, you know, this gets at the point you were just making. If you hold that thought for a minute, and we'll bring in Rosanna Shah as well. And I'm going to show, you're going to show something in a second, but as we do, I want to show the 2019, there used to be a newspaper, you know, sort of like my magazine article. The LA Times has a front page and there's a dynamic image and warnings. And here there's, you go to the LA Times website and there's the ocean. I don't know if folks can see that now. I was sharing the screen just to give them an idea of what the coverage looks like now. Of course, there's a story and in Spanish as well. And what was really novel about what you did last year was you included a game. This gets at some trends that I've been noting and writing about, holding some sessions on the webcast, on sort of the new role of journalism where you're actually not just telling a community a story, but you're engaging the community in a question. And you were a finalist for a Pulitzer Prize for that work, which is congratulations on that. That is a tough hurdle to mount. And here you are. I'd love to get a sense from you of the kinds of newsroom discussion that took place that took the story in that direction toward more interactivity and dynamics.
I've covered, you know, a lot of natural disasters at the LA Times for the past 10 years, mostly disasters that we're familiar with in California, earthquakes, wildfires, drought. But like more recently, I've been focusing on coastal issues, and sea level rise is like the big looming climate change issue on the coast. But it's really hard to talk about sea level rise or think about sea level rise in California when our beach mostly looks like this. Even though, you know, this is a reality that is right now, like these photos were taken very recently. And I love this story. I had this photo up on my desktop as I was kind of working on the project, and a coworker walks past and goes, "Is that Miami?" And I go, "No, that's San Francisco during high tide." And, you know, this is Pacifica. This is a photo we took last year with, you know, it's a town just south of San Francisco. And this is an entire block of homes that have been eroded so much to the point that they are hanging off the coastal bluff. And it's interesting, like I have written like these numbers. I think I was really struck by what David said about just projections, right? And I wrote a news daily for every single one of these new projections. You know, 9 feet of sea level rise by end of century is what the state is now officially adopting for planning purposes. $150 billion in property flooding is what we're looking at. That is, you know, many times greater in economic damage than California's worst earthquakes and wildfires. And we're looking at losing so many of our beaches and all of our salt marshes as a ecosystem. And the struggle though is like when you do these stories, there's no emotion. There is, you know, very easy to glaze over a new study found or a new study says blah, 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 blah. And we weren't really answering the question, like, what do we do about this? So my editor and I kind of like hit pause and thought about like, what is the bigger story here rather than doing these drumbeat news stories that can easily get swallowed into all of the other news cycles. So you showed the online version, Andy, but we took out a standout special section, one section in the newspaper on a Sunday dedicated to this issue, you know, telling our readers, hey, this is important. Sea level rise is a crisis happening now, not later. And then we also had a reference to kind of the online elements that we also made. And, you know, this was a story where we hit pause, stopped doing dailies, and really took a deep dive and went to dozens of cities up and down the coast to kind of look at the adaptation choices that they had. You know, we laid out how all of these choices are difficult and each one has consequences. And we have to make a choice, even though there is so much inaction and paralysis right now. You know, how do we convey that time is of the essence and that even though there's no good choice, we must make one? And so I remember telling my editor in one of our brainstorming sessions, you know, everywhere I go, folks tell me, you know, about sea level rise, like it's a game that they could win. They keep holding back from making any major decisions because they're still waiting for the right solution to drop into their laps. And that's when my editor and I were like, why not create a game? So I thought maybe the best way to do it would just be to play around with you guys. And so basically we called it the ocean game. We kind of kept it really abstract and very simple. This is anywhere coastal town, California. And the sea rises one notch per turn. We don't peg a number or a year to it. And the objective of the game is to save all the homes and the beach before the sea completely hits the road. and you are in charge. I think this is also novel in the sense that we put the reader in the hot seat in making these tough decisions that, you know, have its own set of consequences and sacrifices no matter which decision you make. So you also have a finite amount of funds. We don't tell you how much, because another argument that I see a lot in California is how much all these adaptation choices are going to cost. So, oh no, new flood maps show the sea could rise 3 feet in the next 30 years. Homeowners are begging you to build a seawall. Environmentalists don't like them because they ruin the beach. So in all our test runs and kind of looking at the data, most people go for sand renourishment. So we're gonna do that. And you add sand onto the beach, builds the beach for a year, but you know that was expensive. Too bad all of the sand washed away after a year, which is very reflective of our reality. So congratulations, your town is thriving, the economy is good, the sea has risen a notch, but still feels far away enough. Let's build a seawall just to show you what it looks like. So the seawall put a strain on the city budget, but homeowners are relieved. Yay, the neighborhood council awards you mayor of the year. The sea rises another notch. You are halfway through your funds. People are yelling at you. The beach is getting more crowded. Let's add more sand to the beach. It's amazing how many folks tried this tactic again. And again, the sand washes away after a year. So now we're down to two. And so we have a buyout option that's been there since the beginning of the game. So you go to the buyout, and we don't have enough money to play this. And I would encourage you to go back to the game to kind of play around with the logistics and the logic of it. We put a lot of thought into it. So right now you can't afford the buyout, attempt to raise taxes. So you get one more dollar in your fund meter. Voters are angry, but agreed to give you a little more funding. And for the purposes of this game, let's just end the game and more sand, more beach, but you lose. So the point is, I think, you know, ideally, and it was really cool to see this, like people would play the first time, kind of figure out the stakes. Their impulse was to build a seawall or add sand, which is kind of what you see in reality. And then the second time they play, they start strategizing, right? And then they notice that there is a higher consultant for more information, which is the Easter egg in the game. Many people, very rarely do you hire the consultant in your first turn. And the consultant basically gives you the clues. You know, adding sand will make beachgoers happy, but beware, the sand washes away over time. Seawalls can protect homes, but they aren't good for beaches. If you can afford it, consider buying out beachfront homeowners to get them out of harm's way. And the goal is to kind of show people that planning earlier, starting the managed retreat process earlier while you still have money, might be the better play than these more short-term choices. So let's go back. Yeah, so Andy, you mentioned this. There are, like, journalism games is like a growing space that's been really cool. And we learned a lot from the ones that existed before we made ours. And we noticed that one similarity with all these games by ProPublica and Bloomberg were that they were not only teaching you something, they also were playable. So that's kind of why we had the little gimmicky, cute elements to the game that had to be entertaining. My editor and I holed up in a conference room for more than a week and mapped out the entire decision tree with sticky notes. And then we were like, we have no idea how to actually make a video game. So we kind of brought people into this conference room from the newsroom and ended up finding Shweta Kanon and Terry Castleman, a graphic designer and a computer engineer, who were like, totally, we can make this happen. And they turned this decision tree of sticky notes on a wall into the video game that we just played.
The dynamic you just described in the newsroom is something I'd love to be able to build online, so that folks who are trying to overcome a communication puzzle, like building a better game around something, can find those who can help. It's interesting that even in a newsroom, you had to do some work on that.
Think differently. I was worried about accuracy, right? And kind of really distilling these concepts into an abstract concept that still reflected the truth. And Shweta was thinking about all of the design elements that made this game beautiful and playable. And Terry was the logical kind of computer engineer telling me he found some kind of flaws in our decision tree or figured out ways to make it more efficient. And he also, it didn't happen in the game we played, but he randomized a storm that would happen 20% of the time that would destroy your rock wall and make it. So it's like he kind of also added elements of it that were fantastic. And, you know, the sea level rise project, you know, ultimately helped people understand what it means to be in the hot seat making these decisions. And it really asked readers the question, like, what do you want your coast, the California coast, to look like? You know, on the left is Broad Beach in Malibu at high tide with the seawall and no beach and a $60 million sand renourishment project that they still can't agree on because of the price. And Gleason Beach on the right in Sonoma County loses homes and inches closer to the highway every time I go back. And that managed retreat conversation they've been having has also been going on for almost a decade. And so ultimately we're hoping that we would help people understand like what it means to plan sooner. And, you know, with this project, I think the other thing that really stood out to me was that I think it's gotten better in the last year and a half, but when we write about climate change for a long time, we, you know, the universal, we weren't really differentiating between mitigation and adaptation. And they're both critical, but, you know, climate change, capital C, can feel overwhelming if it's just one big thing we have to worry about and think about. So my project consciously focused on adaptation. And I think this space of adaptation and the fact that we're even having a webinar and conference on managed retreat on its own is kind of a really cool evolution that I think is going to help speed these conversations a lot. So by focusing on adaptation, my story didn't indulge at all in the back and forth of what is causing sea level rise and whether sea level rise is even happening. It doesn't talk about how to curb emissions or how to save the ocean from overheating. We just started in the first three paragraphs with the premise that the sea is rising and we have a lot of tough choices to make on what we choose to save and what we have to let go. And this is a question about what we value and also the economic costs and trade-offs. So great. Yeah, like I think check out the project, latimes.com/sea level rise. And, you know, I thought the conversation about climate change versus climate crisis is interesting. That's a very interesting discussion we're having within our newsroom as well and within kind of the news industry. This headline and the Sunday front page from a couple weeks ago really stood out to me. I was shocked that our copy desk kind of let climate apocalypse go through, but we are in a moment right now where more people are listening and thinking more deeply about climate change and willing to engage in this conversation. And I'm happy that, you know, we're all here today to talk more about how we can get even more people on the train.
Yeah, those issues are so interesting. To me, climate crisis works as long as it's framed both around the vulnerability that's been built to the climate system and the fact that climate change, it has its own forcing on our everything we rely on as well. The vulnerability.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think it's interesting too, because it's like, who is your audience? And are you preaching to the choir or are you engaging new people to the issue? Because do you want to tell them right up front that it's a crisis, or do you want to take them along a journey of stories and facts and things that allow them to really feel this and reach the conclusion by the end of the story that this is a crisis? And I think that's a balance that we're trying to navigate as well, because it is a crisis, but how much of it is hitting someone over the head with it and having them, you know, immediately put up a wall before even finishing the story versus really telling them, this is a story about the places that you care about and the lifestyle that you want to live and the choices that we have to make. And then at the end realize like, crap, I have to do something about it.
Right. And it's the who does what part too. I just want to show one quick slide that I think it's from your state, California. The Digital Globe images of Paradise, California, one of the neighborhoods there that was immolated several years ago. And it's so jarring to look at the imagery, and you see that the windborne embers got to that development and essentially created what Stephen Pine calls an urban fire within a forest. In other words, the vulnerability is enormous, the built vulnerability. And whether or not there was climate change, that was a situation that was bound to happen. So it's a climate, it's part of the crisis to me, is what do you do locally on the vulnerability reduction, even as we work globally on emissions? And that, I think that's part of David's message in his book as well. And the scientists we'll talk to in a couple of minutes also, I think, are really focused on community empowerment, around the vulnerability side and the global challenge on emissions. Vanessa, again, as we said earlier, you're literally on the front lines every weekend and with community tuning into your broadcasts. And CBS has been very active, partially because we have Jeff Berardelli, who's at Weather Prof on Twitter, who's does CBS Sunday morning work, I think, and he's gotten or getting a master's degree here at the Earth Institute and the work you do. So, you know, maybe you could take folks on a journey around this issue of communities getting to understand this landscape of risk that we're building and what do you do about it? How does that come into the weather forecasts, you know?
Well, you gave me the question ahead of time to help me out here and to hopefully guide my conversation. So I will also share my screen, and because Andy thinks CBS is doing a good job, I'm going to prove it to you that we are. But at the national level, keeping in mind that I work at the local level.
Right.
So this is very basic. This is the question Andy gave me to answer. And so what is, can be the role of weather outreach in connecting audiences to the devised or perhaps confusion on climate change? And so with that, I'll walk through a very basic movement of these slides. So first, weather versus climate, which is important for me because my job really involves weather. And by weather, that means your daily numbers, your temperature, your winds, your relative humidity, your precip. And if you're curious what the forecast looks like today, that's pretty nice. And it's warmer than normal. That's where climatology comes into my conversation. So when we talk about climate, it's that long-term look at how things are on average in our local environment. So this is part of my job, talking about the climatology of things. But when it comes to climate change, that's where there is some disparity as to whether or not I, as your local meteorologist, should be talking about climate change. So is it my job? And my answer is absolutely yes. My job should involve a discussion of climate change. However, it can't be my mantra. I can't be up on a box and preaching to everybody about it. It has to be related to what's happening in my community on any given day. So when it relates to news of the day, then I think it can become part of your local news conversation. And some examples here locally in the tri-state area, I would say the most pressing climate change issue would be sea level rise. During Sandy, we were inundated, 13-foot storm surge rolled into the harbor. Things were disastrous, and there are many communities that see regular flooding during normal high tide cycles. But of course, there are other extremes, and this season has been on the quiet side for us here in the Northeast. But if you look at the Gulf and Atlantic coasts, if we had a big hurricane roaring in, that is my opportunity to bring climate change into the conversation. Of course, out in the West Coast, no doubt, and even in Colorado, your local meteorologist is talking about these fires and how weather is driving these events, but it is being worsened by climate change. And this is an amazing video by Daniel Swain of UCLA that I wanted to just quickly share with you guys. Make it big. Hopefully you guys can see, these are fire vortices swirling in Colorado. I mean, just incredible stuff. And he tweeted, and the point is that it was weather that drove this particular event, but climate change was something that made it far worse than it might have been otherwise. Now, when it's my job to talk about climate change, if there's something happening here in the tri-state area, you know, another Sandy perhaps, and it's only going to be worse because we saw like a 6-inch increase in sea level rise between Sandy and the new storm. Well, the big questions or challenges that I face are, first, is the boss interested? And yes, I work under the umbrella of CBS, but each local CBS affiliate is run by its own people. And that's the bosses, and it depends on whether or not they're interested. Now, I'm lucky, and I think because we have a very wide variety of belief systems within our newsroom, that normally they're good. If I say, hey, Lamont has a really cool climate-related story that we should tell, they'd be on board. But I'm not sure that every newsroom across the country gets the same reception. We happen to be in a very liberal environment here, And even if my newsroom might be a little bit more conservative. And the other restriction that I can encounter is there are major time constraints. I don't have the liberty to fill up a whole special section, not yet anywhere, of a newspaper. I get a minute and 30 to 2 minutes to introduce you to the topic, try to get you some facts and information that actually matters to you, and wrap it up with a bow. It is so difficult for me to tell the simplest of stories in that amount of time. So imagine if I try to expand on climate change and how it's all related in that time. It's just not easy for me personally. Some people are outstanding at it. And then that's me. But then you look at meteorologists across the board. And this was a study done in 2017 of weathercasters by George Mason University. And I thought these numbers were pretty sad. It found only 40% of meteorologists were actually interested in reporting on topics related to climate change. And those who did, only did it once a month at about 20% and once a quarter at 65%. But again, in local news, it's so important that it relates to the news of the day. And the other thing I found interesting from the study was that 34% of these weathercasters got positive responses to climate change related stories, 12 negative and 26% mixed. But to me, the most staggering thing is only 40% of us thought, hey, I should include this as part of my responsibilities when the time allows.
Right.
Yeah. And then so that I can prove Andy right, that CBS is doing a good job about relating climate change in national news coverage. This is a study done by Media Matters looking at the number of minutes spent on climate change and the number of segments. And who stands out here but CBS? 118 minutes and 74 segments. This is from 2019. Now, I can show you that this year alone, since September, we've had so many more big stories under the CBS umbrella reported related to climate change. And just a quick video, and then I'll wrap it up, and you'll recognize a familiar face in here.
The living world is a unique and spectacular marvel.
In his new film, Sir David Attenborough's voice is the same, sonorous and soulful, reassuringly familiar.
Dazzling in their variety and richness.
But his message is uncharacteristically alarming.
The way we humans live on Earth is sending it into a decline.
Wildfires burning throughout the West are especially destructive this year. Scientists say they're fueled by climate change. The fires now ripping through several states, leaving a path of immeasurable destruction.
One wildfire after another, and a hurricane season for the record books. Cause for concern, says our David Poe, who reports our cover story.
In the last 20 years, we've experienced twice the number of weather disasters as we did in the previous 20 years. The cost so far, about $3 trillion. Yes, climate change is back in the headlines.
The planet is now warmer than in the entire history of human civilization. It's like we've landed on a new planet with a new set of climate conditions.
If you've been paying attention, none of this is news. What is new is that public opinion about the climate crisis is finally changing.
And to me, it was that last moment, finally changing, that gives me hope. And so in summary, with regard to meteorologists and network news, we are trying to connect our audiences with climate change information, but obviously there's a tremendous room for growth, and I do see it increasing in years to come. And it makes sense for local meteorologists to do it, because did you know that we're considered your station scientists? But also, I was so happy to read this fact that in 2018, a Pointer Media Trust survey found that 76% of our viewers actually had a great deal or fair amount of trust in their local news. I was thrilled to hear that. But of utmost importance for me in reporting a story, and I think what matters to our viewer, is that how does this affect me? And this goes back to what Rosanna was saying in LA, like, what are we gonna do about this? Why do I care about this happening? And that's incredibly important for a story to resonate with our viewers. And if we do it too frequently, it'll be too preachy. And that's why relating it to news of the day, I think, becomes incredibly important. And finally, going back to the election, the most important election of my lifetime, I believe climate change, as it becomes less politicized and more mainstream, which I think we've seen some of that happening, then local media and national media is much more likely to give it even more airtime. And that's my
thought. That was great. A great walk through this, the challenges and the options. We're working a little bit with Climate Central, which has an NSF, a National Science Foundation funded project that's been working with the meteorologists for years and now with newsrooms. It's called Climate Matters in the Newsroom. And I think there's ways for Columbia with all the data we have here to help build modules or the like that can slip into local forecasts and coverage. So we'll see how that all plays out. That was wonderful, Vanessa. So now we're going to get to the science, the point of view of scientists on the need for outreach, both with and to journalists and directly with communities in harm's way. And I was hoping Susanna and Andrew could each tell a very brief story about their own choices they've made in their careers. You know, scientists, you can just get your PhD and work toward the literature pathway toward tenure in your field, studying hurricane dynamics. Or you can look at that in the context of Rohingya refugees on the ground in the Bay of Bengal. And each of you lives in that interface that so many here at Lamont and at the Earth Institute do. You know, it's about the human Earth. It's the sustainability question as much as the basic question of science. So Susanna, maybe you could start with just a little reflection on how you became focused on doing the great science, but also that other component.
Okay, so I'm actually, originally from Brazil, and I studied physics, and then I came to the US and I, you know, did a 180 change in my career and started working with climate and weather, and started on a project of hurricanes that I thought was going to last for a year. And here I am 20 years later until, you know, still working with hurricanes. And one part that was really interesting that I started working with this relationship of hurricanes and climate very early when it was not a hot topic yet. And then we started planning a workshop at Lamont. Then what happened? We had Katrina, and there were two papers, very preeminent papers, saying that, you know, very clearly the influence of climate change in hurricanes. And that all happened a couple of months before our planned workshop that was supposed to be a sleepy workshop between only scientists. And then suddenly was this huge interest, not only of many scientists, of also the media to come. And we were like worried how we are going to do so that the scientists, you know, were able to discuss freely their ideas, but weren't afraid to be in the newspaper the next day, you know, that. So that was a very interesting and eye-opening experience. And then I continued in this field, and some years ago we decided that we would not only want to go so more in this theoretical realm of how climate change and hurricanes, but going to more practical applied view and trying to understand the risk of hurricanes for specific areas and try to give a better sense of that. So we then start developing this project, and that's what led us to start actually led a lot of interaction with, for instance, reinsurance companies, because they are very interested because they have assets. So that's when people start getting, you know, interest when, you know, it hurts their business, it hurts their, you know, how they're going to make money. And also that there was an evolution. When we start working with them, they really want to give me the risk of a hurricane hitting Miami in the next 5 years, the next last year or so. And they were not interested in talking about climate change. They wanted just now, the next 5 years. And now suddenly we see that even they are interested in climate change and asking now us, what can you tell about the risk in 40 years, in 50 years? So we see this change in the interaction and even, we can give them, they're asking questions that they didn't ask before.
That falls into that category, I think what's called climate services. You know, there's meteorology and weather forecasts, and you have sort of seasonal weather forecasts. And then there's that intervening space.
Yeah.
And I think there's a lot of work underway at the Earth Institute in Lamont on that.
Yes. So my role is not exactly doing that, but we are having a lot of interaction that we do that. And the other thing, because I every time there is a hurricane, I get questions one thing I find a little frustrating, that's I try to communicate, yes, climate is changing and is affecting the hurricanes, but we have to think what we're doing in terms of in the building space, in terms of doing new development. An example, I always say, if you have great Miami hurricane from 1926 today, if the hurricane's exactly the same, the impacts and the human losses and the economical losses will be huge and completely different because, what we are doing. We are choosing to continue to build in Miami, continue to the city to expand. So the focus in every time there is a hurricane so much in the hazard itself and not so much on how we are contributing when we are putting more people, more infrastructure into the way of these climate extreme events.
Right. Andrew, from your perspective, I think you have a very interesting life journey that also has these jogs in it. Could you just describe that briefly? And then thinking about this question of how do we propel community resilience and get focus on that big picture about decarbonization as well. How has that all shaped how you're spending your intellectual time?
Yeah, thanks. So I want to build off what Susanna was sharing about this, the idea of choice. Actually, across the panel, talking about choice and prioritization and deprioritization, these things, because it's very present in the international humanitarian community that I work in as well. And I'm going to try to loop back around and share some of the parallels that I found being in the US for a sustained period of time, the past, let's say, 6 to 9 months, thinking a lot about the parallels and the relationships and links there. But yeah, just a background. So yeah, I'm from the local area. I never knew Lamont existed. I'm from Port Chester, New York, and also grew up in Danbury, Connecticut. So yeah, from the area. And yeah, my background is not the typical of someone working at Lamont, I'd say, or even in the space that I work in, kind of at the interface of meteorology, climate, and humanitarian policy. But yeah, initially, I don't know, I wasn't even kind of pushed to go to college. I mean, my family came from Europe and it was like, yeah, okay, if you want to go, you want to work, you work. You want to go to college, you go to college. I mean, I was the first generation. So I finally decided to study finance because I was kind of good at math at school. So they were like, well, the idea is you study finance because you're good at math and then you figure it out later. So that's what I did. I studied finance. I liked it, I guess. Like I was interested in the math part and it was fascinating. But yeah, I was lucky because all during high school and college, I was working as a golf caddy for these like big shots in Wall Street. And they were like, oh, like we'll help you out with like an internship and these things. That's kind of how it worked.
Tips.
Well, yeah, I mean, I wasn't the best. I wasn't really a golfer, but I was a caddy. And yeah, it was great to it was good to have those connections. And I learned a lot about that privileged space that I was in. You know, even as someone like working in the golf course, it was about networking. It was about making the connections. And yeah, I had some opportunities to work on Wall Street, and I did work in the private sector a little bit, but right away I knew it wasn't for me. So my whole life growing up, my mother was a musician, and I've always like played with her percussion and drums. So yeah, I decided, I'm like, you know what, this finance world isn't for me. I'm done with it. I'm gonna be a musician for a while. So that's what I did for about 4 or 5 years, which was great. It's fantastic, and I wish I had more time to do that now. But during that time, I started to think more about what I wanted to do, and I started going back to school at night to study meteorology. So just at a local school, Western Connecticut State University, I would drive from Brooklyn all the way up to Danbury to take classes. And it was, and I did that for a couple of years just to get myself back into, or just think about what I wanted to do next. And then I found the Climate and Society program, the graduate program at Columbia, which now I'm on the faculty for the past 5 years. So, I mean, yeah, it's not the typical journey. I'm not ashamed of it. I mean, it's tough being in the science community to have like a non-traditional background.
I'm going to show your Twitter feed because it illustrates how that intersection of finance
and
climate knowledge is actually pretty important. Maybe you could
to
that point in your, where now sure. You're interfacing those two aspects of things. And then we're going to start to use the last 20 minutes or so to talk about next steps.
Yeah, so this is a tweet. I didn't even know when this tweet was. Okay, but this is the work in Indonesia. So one of the projects, okay, so somewhere along those lines, I had to make a choice if I wanted to go more into, let's say, like theoretical climate research or more on the interfacing side. And I went that route, and there's some reasons for that. I was working at an internship with NASA and also with the Red Cross. And I now support the Red Cross about 30-40% of my time as an advisor to the International Federation of Red Cross. One of the activities is this, forecast-based financing. So this was a project in Indonesia working with the Indonesian government and the Indonesian Red Cross to develop triggers based on flood forecasts to allow for automatic disbursement of funds from the International Federation of Red Cross offices in Geneva for predefined and pre-agreed standard operating procedures to decrease risk of impact from floods that are likely to occur. Not definitely. We are dealing with uncertain forecasts, probabilistic forecasts in this sense. But this is a tweet. I'm trying to read it here. These are some of my other colleagues that are involved that are tagged here. Yeah, and the project is still ongoing.
We don't have to get into the details, but to me, it just illustrates that that we need to have that, well, they call it transdisciplinary or convergence approach on these big problems, because if communities aren't engaged, if finance is not engaged, especially building in places that are implicitly dangerous, if insurance, as historically here in the United States, we subsidized federal insurance for so long that people have been repeatedly reimbursed for building in stupid places. I think 30 or 40 times over for in one case that was in that list of extreme repetitive loss. So that's a critical juncture or critical place for more conversations.
I think can I just sum it up with a couple of reflections? Yeah, so I think I just want to echo a few things that were said throughout the panel too. Vanessa, what really struck me is your comment of, is the boss interested? And I find that as an unlikely phrase to resonate with me, but that's very similar to the work that I do. Who is the boss? Who is the decision maker? Who is justifying who are the most vulnerable? Who's perceiving the risk and making the final decisions of where the money goes? I mean, that's not that easy in some cases, especially I'm reflecting on two situations. One, working with the decision makers in the Rohingya refugee camp, and another one working in the Somali region, a place called Jijiga, where it's very difficult to even map out the governance structures around making decisions. So identifying who the boss is, and then are they interested? And then I struggle with this a lot, and something that I would seek guidance from journalists. How do I communicate uncertainty appropriately so that it doesn't cripple decision-making? However, there is a need and a responsibility from scientists to make sure that people making decisions know that the information we are propagating, we are presenting, is not perfect. You know, and I constantly struggle with this because I've been in situations where it's like, well, the forecast is 70% accurate. And then people are like, no, well, that's not high enough. And I'm like, no, that's actually good. Like, that's a pretty good forecast in some contexts. So, I mean, I'm always struggling with that. And I think it's something that I've learned from working with journalists of how to be a better communicator, specifically on the topic of uncertainty.
Well, Rosanna, you must have had some of that in, again, designing the game. We're all basically in a game in the sense of trying to test what works and engaging the right audience and the right problem. The initiative I'm building here in communication and sustainability, like every communication challenge, always starts with, maybe it's not who's the boss, but how do things get done? What is it that actually changes behavior? And it's still a frontier. We just did a webcast last week on this unbelievably small amount of research money that goes to that end of the climate problem. Like, how do people actually respond to climate risk? And so that's such a key area. And Rosanna, I don't know whether you are doing a fire game, for example, now, but it sure would be a good one to pursue in all across the West, normalizing community design for fire resilience and the like too.
I'm so glad you brought that up because I think the conversation about managed retreat on the coast in California is also a similar conversation that's developing in the wildfire zones. And I loved what Andrew just said about his background, because I was also a quantitative economics person before switching to journalism. But I do think the way we think about these, it's all about costs and trade-offs and value and our value system and what we're willing to pay, basically. And I think it's been interesting to see, like when I started reporting the sea level rise stuff like two, three years ago, the insurance component wasn't really into it. The idea that our mortgage is tied to a 30-year mortgage cycle, like all these things that, like, you know, I finally feel like I understood how to talk about science, right? And I feel like a lot of environment reporters are like that. But we also need to talk about how to figure out how to talk about financial markets and really understand the mortgage industry and the insurance industry, because they play huge, you know, parts in this conversation about how to shift this conversation forward. And until we, at least in California, I think it's different on the East Coast and along the Gulf Coast in terms of, you know, communities that are less, the highest value property in California is along the coast, right? So how do you tell a person who owns a $35 million house that they need to manage retreat? And how do you get the government to buy out a $35 million house or 30 of those along Malibu? And, you know, until the insurance kind of market and the mortgage market and all of that kind of readjust to reflect the true values of these homes in the coming years, which is what everyone's afraid of, right? They don't want their property values to go down. I don't think we can have a real conversation with the real facts laid out. So I think the financial component is something that I'm really curious in exploring. And I'm so happy that there are scientists like Andrew with a financial background.
And that brings up, there was a question from Vivian Gornitz, who's actually at the Earth Institute on timing. And this came up in the context of, I think it was Andrew talking about forecasting. The policy arena always wants precision. And unfortunately, the climate system gives you big questions on sea level rise, on the mix of drivers of wildfire, on what's tornadoes. It's still not clear what's happening with tornadoes in warming climate. And so in the meantime, communities are building and building and building. So communicating uncertainty feels like part of the challenge too. And even as we communicate what's clearly known. And maybe I'd like to get some insight from David on one other aspect of this before we run short of time. Because you've been covering COVID-19 now in depth as well, diving into an arena with significant uncertainty, it's a novel emerging pathogen, right? And you just had a piece, I can't remember if you were tweeting about a piece or you wrote it, about new work that has come out saying that a lot of what we thought we knew in March is not correct. And you know, we're constantly in this context of then the messenger becomes blamed. So in that sense, widening out from climate to COVID-19, is there a grand challenge also in how all of us convey uncertainty? And obviously weather forecasters do this every day in a different way. But David, maybe from your standpoint too, having taken that big landscape of risk.
Yeah, I think how we convey it and honestly how we process it as citizens too. Andy, you mentioned that policymakers want precision, but I think individual decision makers too. And I think to connect something that Andrew was saying with something Rosanna was saying, it's if you're thinking about, managed retreat, you can sort of get your head around it. If you think that this is a binary thing where you know that this house is going to disappear in 30 years, it's a little bit harder to make plans when you're thinking, okay, the risk of flooding has increased by 50%. And that means that rather than this property getting flooded three times over the next two decades, it's going to get flooded five times. Those are all much, much harder puzzles to puzzle through at every level, from the individual all the way up to the governmental. I think for me personally, working through COVID, the biggest meta lesson has been about our difficulties with uncertainty. I remember a few months ago when I was writing a piece early in the pandemic about the limitations of most of the models, which were really only showing what would happen if we continued our current policies indefinitely and not really reflecting much dynamic human response. I was talking about that with my brother, who's also a journalist, and he said, why do you care so much about the models? And I realized that I cared because I really desperately wanted to feel like I knew what was going to happen. It was so important to me to try to get to some firm, concrete framework in which to, in which I could process all the new information. And I felt outraged and betrayed that the models that were being put forward felt inadequate. I feel a little bit about that on climate, where I've started to realize that, a lot of these sort of worst case scenario emissions trajectories for the rest of the century are seeming increasingly unlikely. And yet we're still producing an enormous amount of science on those tracks, which give a sort of imprecise picture of what futures we should be planning for. And I don't know exactly how the public responds to that. Like I said at the beginning, I do think that alarmism has been useful, if it's, even though it may not be a sort of universal communications prescription. I think probably some of that scariness has been helpful. But I also find myself worrying that all of the models that we use to think about all of these systems are really crude, really simplistic. And we want them to give us very reliable answers and give us clear guides about how we should be thinking, as at the political level, at the international level, but also down to the level of family planning and that sort of thing. And I don't know if we'll ever get to that level of clarity, but it's certainly the case that both with the pandemic and with climate change, our models are I think very far from that kind of clarity today. So to the extent that we can counsel the public to take the broad lessons without feeling then that they can take those promises to the bank, I think we're better served. But I don't know that anyone really, as communicators, has figured that side of the problem out any better than the individuals on the receiving end have figured out how to process that information all that well. I think we're broken on both sides of the issue.
I'd love to hear from Susanna on that question of the limits of models. There are other scientists here across the world working really hard on those. It's pretty clear to me after 33 years of writing about global warming that the biggest questions, how fast is sea level going to rise and how hot is it going to get by 2100, are still they're so durably uncertain that it's almost what you would call a known unknowable, meaning that's information though. There is this group called the Society for Decision Making Under Deep Uncertainty. The website is deepuncertainty.org, which is really a cool. They're having their international meeting in a couple of weeks. I spoke at their conference a few years ago. I was like, wow, there are people who actually dug in on that too. So it's like, how much of this, Susanna, do you think is getting to the point with climate the way Vanessa is with weather? In other words, we tune into a weather forecast routinely. We trust, as you just heard, you're the most trusted conveyor information in our daily environment, and we know you're not always going to be right. Can climate develop that comfort factor even with uncertainty, Susanna?
Well, I think we're improving a lot of our models, and we have been put a lot of work to do that. You know, if you compare what we have in our models now than we'd have 20 years ago, it's like, you know, completely different. But I think the fact is there will always be uncertainties. Part of how the atmospheric ocean system works, that, you know, there is chaos is part of it, the same way that, you know, it's part of weather forecast. You can't get around it. So there will be always some uncertainty. But if you look at the big picture and what Jim Henson was saying in the 80s about how much warming would be, it was not, you know, off, was actually quite right. Yeah. So, you know, within some level of uncertainty, but that's the problem. We always think in terms of uncertainty, in terms of probability, and the public has really trouble understanding it and getting that. You know, it's the question that every time I get someone asking, oh, so tell me if this hurricane was impacted by climate change, which is not even the right question to be asked. And what we want to know is how climate change is changing hurricanes in general, and if there can we say if some characteristics of this specific hurricane was influenced by hurricanes, but it's not cause. So it's, the public has even trouble formulate the right question, and really has problems understanding probability and uncertainty. But they don't have problems understanding probability when they're in the casino. So that's
they misunderstand it a lot. And that's why casino owners get rich.
But I think, you know, our models are really improving. Yeah.
Yeah. And Vanessa, maybe again, so we know you have high trust. We know you deal with uncertainty every week, every day in your forecasts. Is there a lesson there for the climate arena that you can think of?
Well, you have to get used to being criticized for being right only 50% of the time, but still having a job. I feel blessed because I feel because of the models and how good they've become that we rarely get it really wrong. Obviously, there are little, you know, there's a few degrees off here and there. But there are only very occasional busts, you know, where it's totally wrong. And I think people just know that that's the case. I think maybe with climate, it's less about probability, but more about what the outcomes will be. So what's the tangible reality, you know, that's what I'm saying is, again, this goes back to how does this affect me? So as opposed to talking about what the models project, say, this is what we envision things looking like. And you as the scientists don't spew the numbers, but paint a pretty picture. I don't know. Maybe that's an easier way for the public to come to grips with the reality of climate change without giving them this weird, like, hey, I don't believe this. This is 70%, that's lame, you know, not good enough for me. But if you say, hey, chances are really good that it's gonna look like you're walking through water in 20 years, maybe that simplifies the conversation.
Rosanna.
Oh, I just wanted to add that I feel like no model is completely right. And I think the people who want to buy themselves time or like deny what's going on will latch onto the uncertainty part of it. But I think what's helpful is also just noting trends, right? I don't think the sea level rise projections in California or anywhere have gone down. You know, we've adjusted how bad it's going to be, but it's only gotten worse. So I think talking about that in that framework, you know, the state of California until 2018 was saying, let's prepare for 5 feet of sea level rise by the end of the century. Now it's 9, and now they're reassessing whether it should be 11. Like, it's not going the other direction, or hasn't gone the other direction in a while. And the other thing that I think there is this weird, like, mismatch in timelines between the news cycle and science. You know, I'll often have scientists call me like 5 years, like they're like, hey, remember that question you asked me 5 years ago on this specific natural disaster or event that happened? I finally got all the data and analyzed it and got peer reviewed and it's now published and now I'm ready to talk about it. And you know, the news cycle was 5 years ago. So I think this conversation of what are we able to say definitively or concretely or kind of authoritatively in a way that allows people in the moment who are thinking about this issue to think about it constructively is a good conversation to always have between journalists and scientists. And, you know, something with wildfires, for example, we can't definitively say what's going on with the wildfires this year, but, you know, I can say that when I first started covering wildfires 10 years ago in California, wildfire season started in September. We started, you know, kind of training our reporters and stuff. And it wasn't until October when the Santa Anas came in that we would start doing wildfire coverage. But now wildfire season is year round and no one's surprised when there's a wildfire in July. And is that, can we specifically attribute that to climate science, like climate change? Maybe not in the way scientists do, but we can frame these stories in a way that get people to think about what's changing in their lives on a day-to-day basis.
So we're coming down toward the last 6 minutes here, and I'd like to end with kind of a brainstorm, drawing on all your skills. David Wallace-Wells is a great narrative storyteller and a reporter, as you've shown, including on COVID-19, with Rosanna Shah, who has worked with gamification. Susanna Camargo, with your work at that interface between extreme weather forecasting at different timescales and community needs. And Vanessa, of course, in a 1 minute, 30 second window, what can you do? And at the initiative we have here at the Earth Institute in Lamont, the idea is to see if there's ways to make better connections between journalists and data visualizers and communities through platforms that might not exist yet. I do think there is a game we could develop around wildfire, living with wildfire. There's a whole group of experts who are working on whether it's house design, ecological zoning, forecasting. You can actually forecast now based on how much it rained last year, how much did the weeds grow that are now going to be fuel. It feels like there's a way for an institution like Lamont and the Earth Institute to interface with the media and communities in ways that can actually maybe break new ground along the lines of the climate sea level game. So David, you know, when you think of that, a narrative matters too, but taking it to that next step of a community actually changing its zoning, for example, what do you have some thoughts on that? And we'll just quickly go around about what we might do together, perhaps just even thinking about a tool, a widget, a process, a better relationship that might work.
This might sound strange since I'm in general sort of skeptical of a lot of private sector solutions, but I do think that the structure of the financial incentives are really important in that they can provide a more nuanced assessment of risk than a lot of government policies do. I think it's been bad for a long time that, along the Gulf Coast, for instance, that the federal flood insurance program sort of acted as a guarantor of property values and actually encouraged building in quite dangerous places. And for a while, a lot of these sectors have been really slow to respond to climate threats. So you're seeing the effects of wildfires in California fire insurance now, but actually just over the last year or two, a few years ago, it climate change hadn't really factored into their assessments. And I do think that that is beyond storytelling, beyond scientific research, a very useful tool because it can, it can, rather than just saying, we need to leave this community, we need to move here, give individuals a sort of more finely grained sense of the risk they face. From my perspective, the most important thing is actually not the fine graining narratively, it's the really big picture, just understanding that climate change is not something that you can escape. It's a theater in which we're all living. It will affect us all to some degree. And we don't yet know exactly how, depending on who we are, where we live. But getting into a conceptual space where you think, my life will be affected by this in some way, now let me think about how, I think is a really vital narrative tool and one that I'm hoping to do more of going forward personally.
And Susanna, in your position and thinking about the relationship with journalists or even other parts of Columbia, there's a digital storytelling lab in the arts that I only recently learned about. two months ago, and I've been here a year, and I'm focused on communication innovation. It should have taken me 2 weeks instead of 10 months to realize we have a digital storytelling lab at Columbia. So what can we do next that might build a better, more lubricated interface for impact?
I think that coming together, communication and scientists, is this whole effort towards storylines in climate change that has been being put forward. You know, Theodore Schaeffer, that's the one that started with that in England, but that's really disseminating along the climate science community. And that's a way that we then make these storylines that can be really, you know, practical and try to make people understand. And it's a way, a better way to communicate what we can expect in terms of climate change. And, you know, but we still have situations like, you know, if you look at the New York Times today, there was this huge article about, you know, the communities along Lake Charles in Louisiana that were affected by two hurricanes. And there was not one single discussion about how to reconstruct differently or thinking about a different way of rebuild the community. The thought was just rebuild exactly as it was before. So it was not even part of the conversation. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is very frustrating that, you know, that's not part of what's going on in the communities that are being affected right now. So if we could somehow put that more in, as part of the conversation from both sides, from the part of the scientists and the part of the journalists, I think that we could move this this whole issue forward.
A lot of what you just described is on the journalists, I think. We're too quick to write the story about the problem and not quick enough to really take it to that step of identifying solutions. There is a solutions journalism network. It's kind of a nascent, tiny part of the landscape of how the news media work, but it's growing. And I think Rosanna's work is really along those lines. David Wallace-Wells' writing, as you follow him on New York Magazine and be interested to see what the next book is doing that. It's great to see Vanessa Murdoch and other meteorologists, weather broadcasters, fitting a little bit of the climate context into what they're doing at Columbia. This issue, whether you call it managed retreat or adaptive communities, or doesn't really matter, but we're having another big meeting in June next year, and we'll keep this conversation going forward. It's been great to have you all here today. Please, I hope the audience will keep enjoying the rest of the Lamont-Doherty Earth Observatory. Lamont Rocks is the hashtag week. It's been remarkable so far. And thank you again, Rosanna, Vanessa, Susanna, and David, and also Andrew, who had to leave early for a family obligation. Thanks for being here, and good luck, and stay safe.
Thanks, Andy.